Honey, we're reading Art and Man by Edwin Swift Balch and Eugenia Macfarlane Balch, published in Philadelphia by Alan Lane Scott in 1918, digitized by Google from its original form at University of Wisconsin. And we are on chapter 1, page 18, halfway down the page. Comparative art and time doubtless will form a connecting link between science and art. Practically, it will amount to forming a new branch of science in which art critics and ethnologists must work hand in hand in a scientific and artistic investigation of art. It is certainly just as necessary that there should be a science of comparative art as a science of comparative anatomy or science of comparative philosophy. Comparative art may be defined as a comparative study of the glyptic arts in all forms, painting, sculpture, drawing, architecture, decorative art, decoration, tattooing, etc. It is not a study of written inscriptions, nor primarily of implements, but it can compare implements and their forms, and the decorations on implements must be one of its chief objects. Not only to the remotest past, in which there was art, but to the actual present and to the future. It must deal with the art of advanced and of primitive races, with such arts as those of the Egyptians, Chaldeans, the Chinese, the Greeks, the Europeans, and also with those of the Platonians, the Bushmen, the Benin, the tribes of Amazon and Congo Forest, the South Sea Islanders, and the inhabitants of Arctic shores. Comparative art must not be confounded with comparative archaeology, for although they touch at certain points, they are different subjects. Comparative archaeology is a study of things of the past, based mainly on results obtained by digging with the pick and the spade. It includes studies of certain phases of art and architecture, of inscriptions, of implements, and of some other things. It does not deal with the art of the Bushmen or the Papuan or the Samoan of today. It is more a historic than artistic study. It can be followed and carried forward by persons who are in no wise art critics. Comparative art is the study of the relations of arts of the world and can be advanced only by trained art critics who are also ethnologists. It is not going to do away with ethnology or comparative anatomy or history or archaeology or anything else of that kind, but probably worked out, it is certain to throw some new light on the story of man. It is a field, still largely untilled, in which there is much work to do, and from which, when it is thoroughly plowed up, a valuable crop of scientific data will grow. In the elucidation of the problems of origin, evolution, descent, and history of man, geography, geology, paleontology, natural history, anatomy, history, philology, archaeology, and other sciences have been called upon to help clear up somewhat the complex genealogy of the human race. Much has been done already, although the problem of man is bound never to be entirely cleared up. The evidence which has been gathered already about man and his origin can perhaps be divided roughly into three classes. That which is extraneous to him personally, such as geographical environment, climate, etc., that is the terrestrial conditions under which he has existed, that which is obtained from his own remains and his own personality, that his anatomical and physiological characteristics, and that which is obtained from his own words and works from which he has produced. This latter class of evidence may be subdivided into three classes, namely language and written records, implements, and art, and this monograph deals principally with the third some class. Language and written records are, of course, most available as evidence in tracing the story of human race, and whenever we find written records, which we can interpret, they bring their part of man's story within the domain of history. But when, as in the case of Old Mexico, we cannot read the words, or when, as in the case of with primitives, there are no written records, and the subject changes from history into prehistory and archaeology, implements form another great class of evidence. The term implements, being used as a comprehensive name to describe all the products of the mechanical arts, a chair or a boat or an automobile, a stone axe or a gun, can be classed as implements. As with some implements, at least no man could live. Did I say without some implements? Yeah. And without some implements, at least no man could live. All our modern implements have evolved from primitive beginnings, as for instance the modern ocean liner, which is the direct descendant of the floating log, the raft, the dugout, and the canoe. Much light has been shed already, and more will be shed on the light story of man by comparing the various implements in the different places at different times. Art is the third great source from which much evidence about history of man can be obtained, but so far it has been investigated only in fragmentary manner. A comparative study of the arts of the world has never been obtained, as it has, for instance, in the case of language with comparative philology, or in natural history with comparative anatomy. One reason, unquestionably, why art as a totality is still so largely unstudied is that it is only in our generation that art specimens from wild parts of the earth have been collected by scientific expeditions, placed in museums, and made accessible to the public. Another reason why art is still unstudied as a whole is that there never has been, there is not, and there probably never will be a museum of the fine arts from all parts of the world. Art specimens are divided. Some are placed in art museums and others go to ethnological museums. There is no place where anyone can go and get a comprehensive view of art. The art of at least half the races of the world has found its way into ethnological museums, where it is not yet culled out as art, but where the specimens are looked on mainly as belonging to the class which is called implements. This rather curious fact, however, allows there is a sort of borderland between art and science, in which much art is stranded at present. That this is a fact may be verified in almost any big city. For instance, in Philadelphia, art specimens are divided between the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts and the University Archaeological Museum in Washington, between the Corcoran Gallery and the United States National Museum, in New York, between the Metropolitan Museum and the American Museum of Natural History, in Boston, between the Museum of Fine Arts and the Harvard University Peabody Museum, in London, between the National Gallery and the British Museum, in Paris, between the Louvre and the Musée de Saint-Germain, etc. In other words, much fine art is at present treated and looked on as ethnology or natural history, not as art. Half of the art of the world is studied by artists and art critics, and the other half by ethnologists. Artists and art critics have so far paid almost no attention to such arts as African or Australian art. In the majority of cases, they are unaware of the existence of such arts. Moreover, if they did not know of them, because these arts do not have the qualities of Greek or Japanese or French art, Art critics haunt art galleries, not ethnological museums. They know nothing of ethnology and doubtless care less. And it takes a good deal of time and thought and study to learn something of ethnology. The result of this is that art critics do not study art at all from the geographical or ethnological standpoints, and that at least half of the art of the world is entirely without their ken. And it is strange to realize how completely many of the arts of the world would have been neglected by art critics. Chinese art and Hindu art, for instance, did not attract the attention of writers competent to deal with their problems until the end of the last century. African art, Australian art, and Amerind art so far have been noticed only by ethnologists. Their qualities and deficiencies, their relations, their resemblances to, and their differences from the arts of other races, as yet have never been taken up by the persons most competent to deal with them, namely trained art critics. Ethnologists, on the contrary, keep away from art museums. As a rule, they have not had any art training. Hence, when they see works of art in ethnological museums, usually they treat them from the standpoint of implements. Only a scientific specialist can really give an opinion about any special science, and similarly, only a trained artist, art critic, can write intelligently about art. Indeed, the present prevailing opinions about art are largely the consensus of opinions of many artist, art critics of modern times. While possibly unconscious of this fact, ethnologists are usually aware of their inability to discuss the aesthetic qualities of art specimens, supposing that they perceive these aesthetic qualities. And hence, while they frequently study the decorative art of primitives, its patterns, its origins, they are apt to leave the aesthetic quality of art alone. To sum up this matter briefly, artists see half of the art of the world from the aesthetic, but rarely from the historic or ethnological standpoint. Ethnologists see the other half of the art of the world from the historic or ethnological, but seldom from the aesthetic standpoint. Neither artists nor ethnologists appear to look at the whole of the art from the aesthetic and ethnologic and a historic standpoint. The result in comparisons, having rarely instituted and lessons to be learned from art, have so far largely remained hidden. The forest is not seen on account of the trees. And as a whole, the art in the world is still an open field in which may be made further discoveries, which will throw much light not only on art, but also on the story of man. Well, there we made it to chapter 2. So, we will go over some tomorrow.